Like to welcome everyone here tonight. Marvin called me, a couple weeks ago and asked if I could speak tonight, and I said, sure. One of the things I really do look forward to is the opportunity to be able to speak on these third Sundays, and about 2 days later, I had figured out kind of what direction I wanted to go in terms of the message that I wanted to speak, and then yesterday morning, I woke up early and wrote it down in 20 minutes. So that tells you kind of my sermon process. Part of my problem when I write sermons these days is I have to cut them up because when I go to write them, they're 4 hours long. So I have to just keep chopping them and chopping them and chopping them until I get to something that we could actually get to in one sitting. So I think I've got this shortened enough that we can get right through this and have a clearly focused message and point as we go. Several years ago, I encountered a series of messages called The Battle for the Beginning. And this was a series of messages. The individual that put them together really did a fantastic job of exposing so much of the fabrication that is evolution. So many of the false facts and so many of the guesses and so many of the issues that are involved with it. And I'm not going to deal with any of those things tonight. I'm not going to attack the theory at all. I'm not going to criticize it. I'm not going to do any of those things. But I am going to present what I consider to be the more important subject than all of this, and that is the biblical record of what we are doing here. And I think it's so very important that as we look at the scriptures, and they are still there, and they still say the same thing they've said for thousands of years, they still testify to the fact that God has done so much for this world, that God in his wisdom decided to create this world, and that we are a result of his absolute care and love and grace. And so to start tonight, I would like to begin in Hebrews chapter 1, verse 1. In that verse, the writer of Hebrews says, long ago God spoke to the fathers by the prophets at different times and in different ways. But in these last days he has spoken to us by his Son. God has appointed him heir of all things and made the universe through him. I love the whole first chapter of Hebrews. In fact, I was going to read the whole thing, but like I said, I shortened the sermon. So we're just going to look at the first couple verses here, which speak to how God and his Son, Jesus Christ, have been working through all of history to get us to where we are today. One of the things that is so important as we look at our young people, as we look at ourselves, that we prepare ourselves for what is said and what is thought about the biblical record of how we got here out in our world. My parents were probably terrified at the fact that I went to a secular university. In fact, I went to two of them. And it can be a very faith-shattering event to go to a secular university, because your faith will be questioned in the classroom. And I, on a couple of occasions, would sit and listen to the professor rant and rave about how Christians are crazy and how what we believe is this, that, and whatever. And I never stood up and questioned him. But I enjoyed sitting in the class and in the lecture saying, you know, you're crazy. You know, and I'm not going to give you the joy of this argument now, but if we ever had the chance to talk this out, boy, wouldn't it be fun, is the thing I kept thinking to myself while I was sitting there. And this individual, his personal life was a disaster. He was getting ready for his third marriage, and all he could talk about was people's beliefs, attitudes, and values, and how you get to have your own, and how you just get to live. And thank goodness for the scriptures that teach us that God has given us something better than that. God has given us more than that, and God has given us the beginning and the creation. So in Genesis chapter 1, the epic statement of all scripture says, in the very first statement of all the Bible, that in the beginning God created the heavens and the earth. It was a very easy verse for me to memorize as a kid. I said, that makes all the sense in the world. Why wouldn't the first verse of Scripture say that? And I think I read that, and I memorized it, and I've never had to re-memorize it again. And it's such a profound verse, though, because it answers all of the questions. How did we get here? God created us. How did the world get here? God created it. How did the sun and the moon and the stars and all of these things come to be? God spoke, and it was so. In those short verses, the most important questions of our lives are answered. And without that simple statement of, in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth, we are lost in this life. We will wander from thought to theory to idea to belief and never be able to hold to a single shred of any of them, because we will never know the substance of any of them. We will never be able to count on the truth of any of those things, because there is nothing to prove them to be true. They're all ideas. So the Bible tells us that God created the heavens and the earth. Well, how do we accept this wonderful knowledge? You know, I heard one debate where the atheist and the Christian were debating, and the Christian said, whether you believe that God created the earth or not, you accept it by faith, and whether you don't believe it or not, you accept that also by faith, because you can't prove that not believing in God is true either. The only thing that will solve the whole issue is when God returns and shows himself to be right, and all of us who said he was right all along get to rejoice in that. And the evolutionists and the atheists and everybody else will say, but I didn't believe. They have faith in the fact that they're wrong. It takes faith to understand that the worlds were prepared by the Word of God. In the second verse of Genesis chapter 1, God said, let there be light, right? And what happened? It was so. It was so. It was spoken. I've often heard preachers say, I believe in the Big Bang Theory. God spoke and bang, it was. I love that joke. You know, it's so true. Because God, as we're going to see here in a couple other verses, by his simple speaking of these things, they come to pass and they come to be, and the world exists because of this. God doesn't sit around and organize armies to build and do the things that he said to do, except in the case of the spreading of the gospel. In all the creative work of all the universe, he simply spoke that into being, and it came to pass. This is one of the great teachings and revelations of Scripture, that God in his creative power simply spoke. And by faith, we understand these things. In other words, we read that the Bible says them, and then we have the faith to recognize the truth of them. We have the faith to recognize that this is the only real, logical, and truthful answer that could possibly be right in the midst of a whole world of ideas. By faith, we recognize these things. Well, what is faith? Faith is the assurance of things hoped for, the certainty of things we cannot see. The believing that heaven is real, and the knowing without a shadow of the doubt that this is exactly what is right. That God is God, that heaven is heaven, that his son died on the cross, and that he will return to save us and bring us with him. All of this is possible by faith. Faith is what brought you here tonight. You may not realize it. You may think, but I just always come to church. You come to church because you believe that what is going to be said is right, or you wouldn't be here. You wouldn't. You'd have better use of your time. We all have better things to do. We come here because God, as I'm about to share in a minute, leads the world through what is proclaimed in the church every Sunday. It is what directs and guides the world and human life. And I'm going to show you an individual that recognized that before I did. So that what is seen was made out of things which are visible. Was not made out of things which are visible. John 1 verse 1. Remember I said God spoke and bang, it happened. John the apostle, in his epic chapter of John chapter 1, begins to explain to this and explain to all of us, and this is a very interesting chapter. You've likely heard, if you've been in the church for very long, this text for years. My two sons, Braden and Garen, if you're opening your Bible right now, circle this chapter, because we're going to be talking about it for a long time. John chapter 1, verse 1 says, "In the beginning was the Word." We look back at Genesis chapter 1 that said, "In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. And he spoke and he said, let there be light. And it was so. And this word," the Greek word logos, which is why I put that in parentheses there so you could know. Many of you already know. "The word was in the beginning and the word was with God. And the word was God." What John is saying here in this very fascinating text is that the Lord Jesus Christ is in essence even the Word of God. And as we read through the Gospels, we will see that Jesus, more than anything he does, will be remembered for what he says. Isn't that remarkable? When we read Matthew chapter 5, 6, and 7, as the students last year in LTC studied those verses for months, ask and you will find, knock and the door will be open to you. Seek that famous, famous verse. This is the message that Jesus shared with us, that he is from God, and that all the things that he says will come to pass. Now, John, in this verse, says many, many other interesting things, which we're going to briefly talk about. Verse 2 says, "He was in the beginning with God." Verse 3 says, "All things came into being through him." Now, the book of Genesis does not explain to us the ins and outs of all of this. The book of Genesis does not explain all the inner workings of this. The book of Genesis is not concerned with that because Jesus, at the time of the writing of the book of Genesis, had not been revealed, right? In fact, all the Old Testament is piece by piece revealing the person of Jesus Christ. It's section after section after section, in generation after generation after generation, until the point where the Son of God finally in John chapter 1 arrives. And so in the beginning, God did create the world. But what we learn when Jesus has come is that there was even much, much, much more to all of this one than we could have ever known or imagined. There is so much more that God would have us to know and understand than even in the hundreds and hundreds of pages of the Old Testament that we find there. And there is so much that God has given and shared with this world that now in the coming of Jesus Christ, the Lord Jesus will begin to reveal and share to us. And one of the most central aspects of everything that God wants us to know about all things is where we started. And where we started was in the beginning. And Jesus needs us to know, wants us to know that he also was there. He also was witness to those things. He also participated in those things. And in this verse, apart from him, nothing came into being that has come into being. What this represents is that in the person of Jesus Christ, all the power and creative mind and insight of God is continuing to come to human conscience. Jesus is just some guy. Our society says Jesus this, Jesus that, Jesus born in a manger, Jesus is a great story at Christmas time. The book of John says, whoa, Jesus is everything and profoundly more than you ever thought. And don't you ever think that this is just about some event or some story. This is about why you exist. This is about why you were made, and this is about why you are here. That all of this has come, and that all of this that God has done has come to pass. So in the beginning was the Word was with God, and the Word was God. The very message and the very genius of God, now in the person of Jesus Christ, speaking to human life. On a whim, I began reading an epic work of literature or listening to it online, let me be clear, over the Christmas break. My family was very upset about all of this. I was profoundly shocked in this epic work of literature by Herman Melville to find in the early chapters the best exposition on the life of Jonah I've ever heard in my life. I told my son, Garen, I said, Garen, we're going to listen to a great fishing story. And he said, okay, whatever. I could have never dreamed when I read, I think it's the 8th chapter of that epic work by Herman Melville about that great white whale, that there would be such an epic exposition upon the life of Jonah that I would never have ever dreamed. And you may say, what does this have to do with anything? Well, let me share with you. In that chapter, the main character goes to church. And in this church, there's a special pulpit, like I'm standing in a pulpit now. Well, in this particular story, the pulpit of this church resembles the front of a ship. And as the preacher gets into the ship, or the pulpit, and begins to speak, in the front of that pulpit rests a copy of the Bible. And all of the meaning about the Word of God being in this particular context with this particular representation becomes very, very interesting. So I want to read you just a couple clips because I think this is just absolutely important to us understanding that the Word of God is everything. It says here, nor was the pulpit itself without a trace of the same sea taste. Its paneled front was in the likeness of a ship's bluff bows, and the Holy Bible rested on a projecting piece of scrollwork fashioned after a ship's fiddle-headed beak. What could be more full of meaning, Melville writes. What could be more full of meaning? The Bible sitting on the pulpit, as it leads us through life, as it guides us in this world. He says, for the pulpit is ever the earth's foremost part. Think about that. You are sitting here in a church experiencing this. The Word of God being preached in all its power, in all of its magnificence, and all that it means and does in our lives. And what Melville says here is that the Word of God in the pulpit and in the preaching of it leads the world, transforms the world, shapes the conscience of the world as much as the church, because the church goes out into the world and transforms the world, as we've been studying in our study of Romans on Sunday mornings. For the pulpit is ever the earth's foremost part, and all the rest comes in the rear. The pulpit leads the world. From thence it is the storm of God's quick wrath is first to cry, and the bow must bear the earliest brunt. From thence it is the God of breezes, fair or foul, is first invoked for favorable winds. Yes, the world's a ship on its passage out. Once we recognize that this world will not endure forever, as this wonderful minister recognized in this message, that the world is on its way to someplace. The Bible says it's on its way to judgment. And when it reaches there, what will happen? The world's a ship on its passage out and not a voyage complete. And the pulpit is its prow. And the prow is the forwardmost part of the ship that cuts through the water. Profound. In the beginning was the Word. And the Word was with God, and the Word was God. The Word leads the world. The pulpit transforms all of society and human life. In Genesis 1, verse 3, then God said, let there be light. And there was light. In 1 John 1, verse 5, John again commenting on these wonderful themes says, this is the message that we have heard from him and announced to you, that God is light, and in him there is no darkness at all. We live in a world of darkness. We live in a world of confusion. We live in a world where so many people cannot sort out what is real from what is not. We live in a world where so many people cannot figure out what the church is about. They cannot figure out what the cross means. They cannot figure out why we keep coming here and opening the Word of God and exploring the profound depths of truth that are in that book. The world can't figure this out. They're so confused. They are so lost in all of the darkness. And John, as he looks at the darkness of his time, says that God indeed is the light that has shown us everything that we need. Verse 6, if we say that we have fellowship with him and yet walk in darkness, we lie and do not practice the truth. These are the people that say they believe in God, but they never show up to worship him. They never show up to fellowship with his people. They never show up to help in the process of loving the people that God has sent his son to save. They say that they recognize who God is, but then in their lives there is no continuation of the meaning of that recognition of God. Because John says, if we know God, there is a path that we walk. If we truly recognize the truth, then there is a way in which we will live. Verse 7, if we walk in the light, as he himself is in the light, we have fellowship with one another. And the blood of Jesus, his son, cleanses us from all sin. This is how the Christian life works. And I think it's so, so, so important. We live in a world and in a time where Christianity is very confused. Many people think Christian experience is Christianity. And just having some type of Christian experience, attending a service, watching a sermon on TV, listening to a Christian song, having a conversation with a Christian, somehow equals salvation. It doesn't work that way. And what John is saying here is that Christianity operates like this. We walk in the light of everything that Jesus has told us, and we represent all of these things, which means we have to know what they are, which means we have to study and learn all of the things that the Bible teaches us to do and be, and in its simplest, simplest terms, we simply imitate the Lord Jesus Christ in its simplest way. As a result of this lifestyle, we walk in the light. We have fellowship with one another as we have right now, as we're sitting here, as we go throughout each day, as we love each other more clearly and more dearly with every moment that we have left. And then also, the blood of Jesus cleanses us from all sin. Well, I'm not perfect, am I? My wife will remind you of that. She reminds me of that, and I'm so thankful for it. I might get to some thinking that somehow I have achieved some level of greatness if it wasn't for my wife reminding me that I am not as great as I think I am. Boy, would I be in trouble without her. And I'm so thankful. And sometimes it's not easy to hear. Sometimes it's not easy to recognize that we still wrestle with the sinful thoughts and the sinful problems. And sometimes we still fall into sins as we try to live the Christian life as best we can. And we look to God and we ask for forgiveness. And the church forgives us. God forgives us. And we begin the process of being restored again. I can tell you that I have been through that process 3 or 4 times. I have fallen into sins in my life that took me out of the song leading for a while, took me out of the praying for a while, took me out of everything for a while. But I submitted to the process of how we are forgiven. And I asked for forgiveness. And I asked for people to give me another chance, God especially. And obviously, here I am again. But the process says we are not perfect. And the world looks at the church and it says those people are sinners. And guess what? They're right. But what they don't recognize is that we have submitted to the Lord Jesus and to his offering of salvation and to the forgiveness that he offers and in the repenting of our sins and the turning away from them and all of that, God works through that and we become more and more like him through that process of walking in the light. I hope as I say that, we begin to see that the Christian life is a process of purification. The Christian life is a process of growing closer to God, growing more like God, becoming more and more right, even though we're making mistakes along the way. Even though sometimes we don't make as good of decisions as we would like to make. We can be forgiven of every mistake we make in this world if we let God forgive us of it. But it all starts with our heart. We have to walk in the light. If we do, we will have fellowship with one another and the blood of Jesus, his Son, will cleanse us from all sin. Final point. John 1 verse 9. There was the true light, which coming into the world enlightens every man. What does that mean? What does it mean that the light of the world, which has been shown and has come, enlightens us? He was in the world, and the world was made through him, and the world did not know him, and that is why they crucified him. And in this process of the world not knowing the God that made it, of the people not knowing the very instrument of their creation, and of them putting the very creator of their lives and souls on the cross, and of him submitting to that and dying for us. Verse 11, he came to his own, and those who were his own did not receive him. But as he was crucified, and as he died for our sins, and then as he rose from the dead, all of this by the sovereign will and plan of God, but as many as received him, to them he gave the right to become children of God. Did you know sitting here tonight that you are not a human in the sense of a human being? Remember the verse in Genesis? He said, let us make man in what? Our image. Humanity is not an afterthought. Humanity is not a spontaneous accident. Humanity is not an evolutionary experiment. Humanity is the divine representation of God himself. And as he sent his Son into the world to enlighten every man, to show and to give the opportunity for every single person who ever lives, the opportunity to be with God in heaven forever, this is what this means. He has given the world enlightenment. He has offered the world eternal salvation. Now, will everyone choose this glorious opportunity? No. That's why he says he was in the world was made through him, the world did not know him, and even coming to his own did not receive him, even crucified him. But as many as did receive him, and we know those who did, and they are famous. As we read through the New Testament, Paul and Peter and all these people, thousands of years later, we know their names. We know their lives. We know their work. Why? Because they shared the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. And the effect of that is eternal. The effect of that has eternal reach and consequence. As many as received him, to them he gave the right to become children of God, not just human beings anymore. Eternal life is for those who have chosen to become like God. Remember I said our job is to imitate God? This is the becoming of the children of God, even to those who believe in His name. Can you become a child of God by just having a Christian experience with absolutely no belief at all? Not really. No, it just doesn't quite work that way. That doesn't involve walking in the light or any of the things I talked about. But believing and receiving and then walking in the manner worthy of the calling we have received is indeed what is required of us. And of the opportunity that we have and that we take hold of and that we hold on to each day and each moment. And we never let anything in the world shake us from that or shake our understanding of these things. And this is why we have come tonight. Who were born not of blood, nor of the will of the flesh, nor of the will of man, but of God. This is what a Christian is. That which is born of the will of God, saved by the will and power of God, and protected by the love of God. Perhaps tonight you have not experienced this transformation. Perhaps tonight your eternity is not secure. Perhaps tonight you have many questions about how all this works and what all this means for you. And perhaps tonight you do need to explore what this means. We would love to share with you, to study with you, to pray with you. We would love to be of any service to you that we can be, if you would allow us to do so while we stand and while we sing.